Okay. Salutations to one and all present here. My name is Sreemay Rath. The presenter was a bit too kind with the follow group accolades there. Trust me, I'm not worth any of them. My only worth in this world is simply to realize that if a few people can go back today and pick up that book of Sylvia Plath that I've had lying around in the corner for a very long time, my job here will be done today. That trip from Ahmedabad wouldn't seem all that tiring because I'll see a few gleaming faces today filled with joy towards the endless endearment towards the world of poetry. So, today's theme is dreams, visions, and everything in between. And that's exactly what I'm going to talk about. Let's talk a bit about the devil, shall we? So the greatest trick that the devil had pulled was to convince the world that he did not exist. And that's what all of us should do. If at all we have a flaw in ourselves, like I do at times, I tend to stammer in between. And I've stammered a lot in the past. But to convince the world that you can use your flaw as your own superpower, now that itself makes you a superhero in your own right. I'm sure all of your politically conscious citizens, and since general elections are just down the line, you would know that in parliament, usually proceedings that happen are based around two leaders of parallel statures. On one hand, we have a liberty prime minister who although is a very great orator and his policies are liked by some and liked by none. But I am here to be politically neutral today. And the second leader who belongs to a dynastical political family. Now, let's talk a bit about the other guy today. Now, every single day we see hordes and hordes of memes giving us preconceived notions about how the other opposition leader tends to have certain flaws about himself, which leads us to think that what truly sustains that? I mean, the person is fairly qualified, he's studied at some of the world's best universities, they are pretty much publicly accepted as the pioneers of education as they are, yet the person, the leader in concern, gets up every day in parliament and goes about his business to such an extent that he's even gone on to hug our own prime minister, keeping all blemishes aside. Now let's not talk about all these great personalities. I'll give you a more common example. Let me give my example. 6 years ago, I'm not all that confident. Trust me, I would have goosebumps right down in my legs. They would start shivering before any. I believe they're shivering a bit right now, but I'm a bit. I've thicker pants today, so you wouldn't know that. So 6 years ago, I was in the fifth grade. I was asked to speak a bit about the Bangladesh Liberation War by my teacher. Now, mind you, I knew everything there was to know about the war. I knew Sheikh Mujibur Rahman is the father of Bangladesh, and General Ziaul was one of the architects in the victory against Pakistan. However, I didn't know how to go about my business. I didn't know how to present myself. And before I knew it, even though there were 20 students in the class, I could feel that 60 eyes were prying upon me. They were waiting for me to make a mistake. And that's what I did, what every introvert does when confronted the situation. I peed in my pants. Yes, I did. It's a laughable matter. I laugh at it every other day when I tell my classmates about it. But I'm glad that situation happened. Not that I peed in my pants, mind you. The very general aspect of things that happened with me, it sort of made me come out of my mold. That no matter what you speak, no matter how you say it, there are going to be people who you are going to displease at times because you really can't keep everyone happy, can you? And growing up as kids, especially the Indian education system, you're always compelled to act in a certain manner. You're supposed to be that bright, brilliant student who mugs up NCERT textbooks, who goes about their business, who talks to teachers, who happens to be a teacher's friend. I was all of that. I was a nerd. I used to spend hours in the library reading Ernest Hemingway, William Shakespeare, Christopher Marlowe. And maybe that's where I found my calling. Maybe that's where I found my solace. I wasn't that big of an extrovert while growing up, and neither am I now. Trust me, half an hour after finishing my talk, you'll find me binge watching on an episode of Brooklyn Nine-Nine on Netflix. But that's just who I am. And it's fine to be that whimpering kid in the sixth grade who you don't necessarily need to pee your pants, but If you whimper, if you're grasping for air, it is fine. This is simply a phase, and I'm glad that it happened with me so early in my formative years. Let's talk a bit about how I overcame that, the whole process that was involved in it. People call me a prolific writer. I don't think that. I really don't. All I feel is that my writing is an escape from my own demons. I got rejected by 48 publishers in the first 2 years of writing. My grandfather, God rest his soul, he was the one who came up to me telling me that you should put your hand to writing, you should write poetry. I got a bit swayed away by it, I'll be very honest. I mean, isn't that what we all are? We are all products of a generation who have been made to believe that they are extraordinarily genius. But then when you head into college or when you're in the upper grade, you realize it's just above average. And that sort of takes your morale down. And that's exactly what happened with me. So I was a bit astonished, how can 48 publishers reject me? My bet was 5. The 6th one would have definitely published me. But then something brilliant happened. There was this competition held by Kindle India, it's called Write to Lead. They were selecting young authors from our school where you give a few of your manuscripts, and if you were lucky enough, you'd be selected on a 3-book deal. It so happened that I happened to give my manuscripts, much to my own dismay, because I was pretty much at my wit's end by that time. Then again, 6 months down the line, I got a lovely mail in my box, and I was praying to God that it's not a detention notice because I was very low in attendance at that time. However, it turned out to be that I was one of the 25 writers from Asia who was offered a 3-book deal with Kindle. That, I believe, is one of the defining moments in my life. That led me to believe that no matter how many classmates and teachers and peers and even some of my own relatives would dissuade me from writing, it did not stop the ember that burned in my heart. And that is exactly what I have come here to convey the message to you. That life can seem tough at times. You can be at your wit's end. The obstacles are going to be against you. And the odds are always going to be against you. However, one day, you can decide that when you get up, this is not going to affect me. This is not going to encroach upon me in any way. I am going to let my creative process or any process towards my creative inhibitions take flight. And that's when you decide that I have arrived. So if you do go back home today and not necessarily watch any shows on Netflix, please don't do that. I'm way laid back on attendance as it is. This time it's a college, but it's a bit level playing field. You have a lot of other methods which I'm not supposed to mention on camera on how you get attendance done. But that's the thing. You go about life, you're a bit disorganized. You don't keep your bed well. You don't organize your books. You don't keep your clothes tidy. But don't let that stop you from doing what you do best. Now this is an engineering college. So I'm sure growing up, you're fascinated by algorithms. You're fascinated by complex equations. You're fascinated by modern day technologies and innovations that shaped and molded human life as it is today. That should be the same passion that should enter inside you when you're done with your 4-year course. To not go back to some abroad, country abroad, and make ends meet by earning hundreds and thousands of dollars. You should come back to your country, and if you don't even plan on coming back, innovate something, create something that changes human life, and that effect comes back to your country if you don't come back necessarily. And that's what should drive us in this day and age. In this monotonous age where all of us are low on morale, where we don't really think a lot, where we're impulsive thinkers basically. We're like, oh, I'll live life in the moment, we'll see. I don't need a piece of paper to change or decide what my future is going to be. That attitude is fine. It is absolutely fine. But as long as you're doing something in life that does not put you in a void and divulge of regret 10 years down the line. So by saying this, I put a pause to my thoughts, and I thank you all for your undivided attention. Thank you so much.